Hello, welcome. I'm Ruki Newhold Ravikumar, Acting Director of Cooper Hewitt Smithsonian Design Museum. Hi, I have the honor and pleasure of serving as the moderator for this session. We're going to use the Q&A and chat features of the platform for this session. If you have a question for the presenters, please use the Q&A option to send me your question and I will ask it at the end of the session. I'll be adding links and resources to the chat throughout today's presentation, so look out for them. This session will also have live closed captioning. As the acting director of Cooper Hewitt, I'm based in New York City. My background today is the gorgeous Great Hall in Andrew Carnegie's home that we are located in. The Smithsonian has 19 museums and two are located in New York City. But when I'm not in New York or Washington, DC, I call Oklahoma home. So I'm excited that our presenters are from Tulsa Public Schools in my home state. They have done some impressive curriculum development work to bring into classrooms a story that has for long lived in the shadows. This session is titled, We Have a Hard History and We Teach It, Grappling with the 1921 Tulsa Race Massacre. Welcome to our teachers from the public school system, the Tulsa Public School System. Our first speaker is Tametra Jamison. Tametra, over to you.
Thank you so much. First off, I just want to say thank you to the Smithsonian for giving us this opportunity. Myself and our team, we are so excited to be here. Of course, we teach hard history, grappling with the Tulsa Race Massacre, and that is our topic for today. I am an educator for over 17 years here in Tulsa, native Tulsa. My family is actually survivors of the race massacre, so this is true and dear to my heart. We are so excited to be here. Our session goal is to provide an overall view of the TPS lessons on the Tulsa Race Massacre in Black Wall Street. Just as Ms. Ruki has said, the chat feature is available and links will be given to you. Place questions in the Q&A for us, for them to be addressed at the end of the session. Black Wall Street for us, especially as Tulsans, is a symbol of what possible. By 1920, Tulsa, Oklahoma was a segregated city under the Jim Crow laws. The Black community flourished in the Greenwood District. Greenwood was the wealthiest Black community in the country with over 200 Black-owned businesses. It was commonly called Black Wall Street. Beginning in 1918, an increase in lynchings and attacks on Black communities occurred around the country. More than a dozen communities were attacked by 1921. Many Blacks spoke up saying they would not stand by and let racial violence continue. In 1921, a Black Tulsan was accused of assaulting a white woman and a group of whites went to the courthouse to lynch him. They were met there by a group of Black men who wanted to ensure a trial would happen and not a lynching. We have a short video with Dr. Hill that will explain what actually occurred at that moment. Please roll the tape. Thank you.
Downtown, some of which are veterans. And then you have whites who are coming downtown enraged, incensed of a rape. I mean, so you had a coalescing of a number of factors. The second group of Black men who come downtown, one of the white men in the crowd attempt to disarm them. And in attempting to disarm them, there's a melee that occurs. And in that ruckus, a shot is fired. It's a white bystander. Within minutes, this is an all-out gunfight. Black men who have come downtown recognize that they are outnumbered, try to make their way back to the Greenwood District. Whites are in pursuit. And so Black men recognize that during the evening hours and the early morning hours, they were able to block the mob from invading the community. But by 5 a.m. on June 1, whites had not only amassed on the southern border, but also along the western border of the community. And not just several hundred whites, we believe there were thousands of whites. We believe between 250 and 500 white civilians, right, are deputized and told to arrest, detain, and kill, if necessary, black people who were quote unquote in rebellion. Around five, what sounded like a whistle blew. And that was a signal to invade the community. Tulsa Police, Sheriff's Department, as well as National Guard participated in this and began to shoot and kill black people who offered any kind of resistance or black people who were fleeing the violence. There were airplanes. They were dropping explosive, some sort of incendiary bomb. There's also recollections of machine gun fire, from multiple places firing on the community. And in addition to that, whites are going from house to house searching for black men or black people who are armed, who are offering resistance. And what you saw from 5 a.m. to 11 a.m. was literally the total near destruction of a 35 block area that had been home to one of the wealthiest black communities in the country. After the dust settled and the smoke cleared, white voices in the city began to blame black people for what occurred. And then also at the same time began to say, well, this is an opportunity for us to transform the Greenwood District into a train depot. This wasn't just a massacre. This was an attempted expulsion of the community. And
one thing about my family story is that my ancestors, they did run for their lives and they survived with the thought of hope. They wanted to carry on our family's legacy of perseverance and desire to live well. So we stayed in Tulsa and did great things. I would like to introduce to you Ms. Akela Leach, a native Tulsan.
Hello, my name is Akela Leach, and I am a fifth grade English language arts and social studies teacher here in Tulsa Public Schools. I also attended Tulsa Public Schools as a student. And I help write the third through fifth grade elementary Tulsa Race Massacre lessons. One reason why these lessons are so important to us here in Tulsa is because of the conspiracy of silence that began immediately following the Tulsa Race Massacre. No justice was served and no one was held accountable. Many government organizations and local institutions were complicit and helping cover up what happened. So everything from the local newspaper at the time, to the Tulsa Police Department, to the city of Tulsa, many organizations contributed to this conspiracy of silence. Many people also did not talk about this in private spaces. We don't know for sure all of the reasons why, but we can predict that it was a combination of trauma and shame that kept people from talking about it and kept it from being taught for many years. My father grew up here in Oklahoma and he attended segregated schools. And in fact, he attended schools near Langston University, which is the only historical black college in Oklahoma. And his teachers would have been alive during the Tulsa Race Massacre, or they would have had family members who would have been alive during that time. And he did not learn about the Tulsa Race Massacre. He didn't know that it even occurred until he became an adult. And this is a very common thing for anyone who grew up here in Oklahoma or in Tulsa. From the 1920s and 1940s, many people did stay here in Tulsa and they rebuilt Greenwood. In fact, it was even stronger than before. But unfortunately, in the 1970s, urban renewal and Highway 244 being built contributed to the decline of Greenwood. In the late 90s, the Tulsa Race Riot Commission convened, and this was a combination of community members and public officials who wanted to bring attention to the fact that the race massacre happened. And I want to note here that at the time, it was still referred to as the Tulsa Race Riot. So that's why it was called the Tulsa Race Riot Commission. And this is the first time that it was ever spoken about in a public space since the 1920s. This led to the Tulsa Race Massacre being added to the Oklahoma Social Studies Standards for US and Oklahoma History for high school courses. So here in Tulsa Public Schools, we are committed to ending the conspiracy of silence. That is why we have launched lessons from grades 3rd through 12th grade. So students will be grappling and learning about the Tulsa Race Massacre in a grade level appropriate way every single year from the 3rd grade on through the 12th grade. And we did this because we believe that the classroom should be a safe place for students to learn about the past and learn how to think critically about the present. We also thought it was important to not just focus solely on the race massacre itself, but for students to also learn about Greenwood culture, to learn about the Black Wall Street community and the resiliency of the community. And so we would like to invite educators across the country to also teach about the Tulsa Race Massacre, as it is a part of our shared American history. Now, Amanda will explain how we teach this in courses that do not have the Tulsa Race Massacre as part of their standards.
Thank you, Akela. My name is Amanda Soliván, and I am the Social Studies Content Manager for Tulsa Public Schools. And my role in this project has been to oversee it from its vision until its completion, and I have contributed to most of the lessons. Many of you may be in states that don't have the Tulsa Race Massacre as a content standard, and you can be saying to yourself, well, how do I cover this? One way that you can do so is to look at the content standards that you're already covering and to consider how you could use the Tulsa Race Massacre or Greenwood as an example. In a world history course, if you're teaching the Holocaust or about apartheid, for example, you could discuss the Tulsa Race Massacre as another example of restorative practices. Or if you're teaching a civics class and looking at different systems of government and the court systems and the judicial branch, then you can use the Tulsa Race Massacre as an example to discuss whether or not there's legal standing for reparations. If you're not going to tie the Tulsa Race Massacre specifically to content standards, you can also tie it to skills. The Tulsa Race Massacre can be used as a content if you're looking at literacy skills associated with reading, writing, or speaking. Another common question we have is, how do you teach the Tulsa Race Massacre in elementary schools? And I think we first need to really look at elementary students and consider what they know and how they see the world around them. Even third grade students have started to notice that there is inequities in our country and within our schools. And many of them may have already experienced some type of inequity within their school itself. And so even though they may not yet have the words to be able to describe this, they do have some experiences. So in addition to first being able to create a classroom community where our third graders can talk about the Tulsa Race Massacre, we need to give some vocabulary and an example that they can understand. To do so, we start with the Sneetches video. The Sneetches video has creatures that have stars, the star-belly Sneetches, and don't have stars on their bellies. The difference between these two creatures enables us to talk about diversity. The star-belly Sneetches have privileges that the non-star-belly Sneetches don't have, and students are able to see how that impacts the non-star-belly Sneetches in the community as a whole. This enables them to talk about discrimination. Following that, we have students that participate in a read aloud about the Tulsa Race Massacre using a children's book. For our fourth and fifth grade lessons, we didn't want to focus solely on the Tulsa Race Massacre. Rather, we looked to the Black historical consciousness framework, which talked about Black agency and perseverance. Instead, we decided to focus primarily on the development of Black Wall Street and the resilience of Black Americans in rebuilding Tulsa's Greenwood District following the massacre. Our fourth grade students also need some front-loading of vocabulary, so we used a series of video clips with children and parents discussing racism and segregation before moving into the development of Black Wall Street, the massacre, and then the resilience following the massacre. Another question that you might have is, what about a possible conspiracy of the silence again? According to Education Weekly, in August, 26 states had bills that were proposed that could limit the discussion of racism in different states. And Oklahoma is no different. In May of 2021, House Bill 1775 became law. And many of us worried that a conspiracy of silence would happen here again, because this law was going to list what we could not instruct regarding race and sex. What we found was that the rhetoric around the bill did not resemble the actual bill itself. The bill itself says that we can teach our standards in Oklahoma, which means that we can not only teach about the Tulsa Race Massacre, but other issues of social justice as well. From this experience, we learned that we needed to differentiate for teachers the difference between the actual law and rhetoric, to let them know what they could instruct. And by providing them with lessons and other materials, we could professionally protect them at a time when they did not feel safe. At this time, Emily is going to talk to you about how we can build classroom communities for having hard conversations around racism.
Thank you, Amanda. Hi, everyone. My name is Emily Harris. I have been teaching with Tulsa Public Schools for 8 years. I currently teach AP US History and Government at Will Rogers College High School in Tulsa. I come into this project as the person that wrote the Tulsa Race Massacre government lesson. Additionally, I served on some review committees for the other lessons, and I also have experience leading professional development for teachers to teach the Tulsa Race Massacre. I come into this work also as a native Tulsan. I also recognize that I am a white woman teaching the Tulsa Race Massacre, and I teach at a school with predominantly students of color. So when I'm teaching this, I recognize that I could be teaching descendants of survivors and victims. In order to have difficult conversations with students and teach hard history, teachers must first build and establish a classroom community. In order to do this, teachers can use tips from the Before You Begin section that we have on our cheat sheet. We have created a cheat sheet for all participants that Ruki is kindly going to put in the chat for us. And this cheat sheet has access to all of the links that you need to access our materials. So in order to create a very solid foundation in your classroom to teach hard history, it's necessary to review some of these tips. One of the first things that I do with my students in my classroom at the start of the year is that I have them establish a safe person. I let them know from the very beginning that in history, we're going to have conversations that often are going to be complicated and difficult. I let students know that when they establish a safe person, an adult in the building, that is a person that they are able to talk to and open up to whenever classroom conversations do get hard. And that way they're able to better process their emotions. So for example, when I was teaching the US history lesson in my classes last year, I noticed that during a visual inquiry activity where students were going around the room and looking at different photographs, I noticed that there was a conflict between two students that came up. And that conflict, after listening and understanding what happened, one student was looking at a photo that included a lynching, and the other student perceived that they were not taking it seriously enough, that they weren't able to look at the photograph and have the proper emotion in response to that photograph. So because of my classroom culture and knowing that I'm able to de-escalate situations that might arise in my classroom, I had full confidence in that moment during that conflict that what I could do was to pause, and for a minute I would talk to just those two students and let them know that they might not ever be able to change each other's mind on a subject, but what's really important for them to do is to listen to each other and to be able to hear different perspectives. So next, Tametra, would you be able to share some tips that you've used in your middle school classes?
In middle school, we know those beautiful teenagers can sometimes be a little selfish.
And so one thing that we decided to do was to make sure they understood local events like local history and along with nationwide. We wanted them to emphasize with the struggles that Americans and others have gone through for social justice. So we made sure to give them a widespread of information and just get them to understand that they can too change the world. Akela, how did you do with the elementary kids?
Well, elementary students really like to feel like they are learning, they like to learn about facts, and they like to feel like they're learning something important. And so I told them from the very beginning that they were learning something that was difficult for adults to talk about and that hadn't really been taught very much before. So that immediately piqued their interest and set the tone for the lessons, and they took it seriously from the very beginning. Also, I think it's very important to be prepared to pause when needed. Elementary students are not always prepared to articulate all their feelings, but they are able to journal and draw pictures. So one of my classes last year got very emotional after watching the video that explained the events of the Tulsa Race Massacre, and many of them cried afterwards, not because it was too tough for them to watch, but because they felt so much empathy for what happened. And so we paused, and the students were able to journal, and they were able to sketch words and just draw pictures to express how they felt. So now Emily's going to give us some more tips about how to find tips on the cheat sheet.
Yes, so on this cheat sheet, there's a section that says classroom culture before you begin. So that's where you can find tips that are very specific for elementary students, as well as another link that's specific to secondary students. And now Amanda is going to talk to us about the next part that's on the cheat sheet, which is about the compelling questions.
Awesome. Thank you, Emily. So anytime we are instructing on hard history, we recommend that teachers use inquiry. This is because inquiry allows students to look at a variety of primary and secondary sources with different perspectives, synthesize it, and come up with their own response. And there will be multiple right answers. For our Tulsa Race Massacre lessons for grades 4-12, we use inquiry. These lessons are surrounded around compelling questions. These are sometimes called essential questions or focus questions, and they're the inquiry-driven questions that students address throughout the lesson. On the cheat sheet that has been put in the chat, you can see on the third row down, it says lesson plans focusing on compelling questions. There are links to multiple lessons, and next to them is the compelling question that each one addresses. Akela is going to talk to you about the elementary compelling questions.
Yeah, so I want to point out that the third grade lesson does not have a compelling question because it is a read aloud, but that read aloud does break down for students concepts like discrimination and diversity. For the fourth and fifth grade lessons, we felt it was really important to center our lessons on Black agency and resiliency, the development of Greenwood and the rebuilding of Greenwood. As a student in Tulsa Public Schools, I did not learn about the Tulsa Race Massacre very much, but what I did learn about focused on, at the time, it was called the Tulsa Race Riot, and we only learned about the events of those days. So I did not learn that Greenwood was even rebuilt until I started writing these lessons. There's so much that I realized that wasn't taught to me before. So we felt it was really important for kids in fourth and fifth grade to really focus on learning about the people and learning about the stories of the people and how they demonstrated resiliency and agency. And now, Tametra, can you share with us about the middle school questions?
Sorry about that. Yes, our middle school lessons, I love them so much. As a middle school teacher for over 13 years, we really hit it hard. We talked about in eighth grade about the embracing self-defense, because there were African Americans who were trying to stop it from happening. Of course, we heard earlier, they wanted to stop the lynching from occurring. And so we focus on that and how students can become self-advocates for social justice. In seventh grade, we discussed about the financial loss. As a descendant, myself, my family, we lost all of it. We lost our memorabilia, no photos, none of those things were passed down to our family. So not just the tangible things, but also the trauma. In sixth grade, we talk about gentrification of Black Wall Street. Over the years, it has been turned over through the city and different aspects. And so we want to teach them about the government and what gentrification looks like. Emily, can you show us also about high school?
Yes, thank you. So the high school lessons, we really wanted to focus on issues that we grapple with in our history nationwide. So this includes how we teach our history, but also we look at questions of reparative justice and reparations. In the government lesson, it's about whether or not the victims and descendants of victims of the Tulsa Race Massacre have legal standing for reparations. In many communities, the word reparations can be controversial. But when I was writing this lesson, I felt it important to be able to make this lesson not about a debate on whether or not the victims and descendants of victims should get reparations. Instead, what this lesson is it has students take on the role of a legal counselor, and they are determining whether or not there is legal standing. So the debate is if those seeking reparations are going to receive them, what is the best path and method, whether it be through the judicial system or through legislation, for them to receive reparations. Our world history lesson looks into issues of reparative justice and what makes a good apology. The question is, has the city of Tulsa made amends for the Tulsa Race Massacre? So what makes this a good lesson for world history is that it looks at if any wrongdoing is done. So for example, you could look at the Holocaust or the Rwandan genocide. Anytime there's wrongdoing, how is repair made? What makes a good apology? And then the US history lesson looks at how we should tell our history. So for example, when I was a high school student in Tulsa, I only learned about the Tulsa Race Massacre in my Oklahoma history class, and I learned about it from a textbook. At the time, it was still referred to as the Tulsa Race Riot. And I only learned about what happened in those 2 days. I never learned about the causes of the Tulsa Race Massacre. I never learned about the injustices that the survivors had to endure after the massacre. And I also didn't learn how this event is connected to historical trauma. And so one thing that the conspiracy of silence did, and that lack of dialogue that existed in our community for over 80 years, is that it created generational historical trauma. And that's an example of how this massacre still impacts our community today, over 100 years later. So it's important that when we are teaching students how our history should be told, that we're making sure students know that history has to be told from a variety of perspectives. To tell the full event, you can't just listen to one perspective. Multiple perspectives have to be able to share their story. So now Amanda is going to help us understand supporting questions.
Thank you, Emily. You might have looked at some of those compelling questions and felt like they were huge, and your students would need a lot of scaffolding in order to answer those. And our students are no different. So we've developed a series of supporting questions. These are baby questions that can help to scaffold student learning to answer a larger, compelling question. Housed in these supporting questions are interactive activities that use primary and secondary sources. At the end of each supporting question, students will answer a part of the summative, so they don't have a large summative project left for the end of the lesson. Each supporting question is formatted the same way. They include an estimated time, an objective, an overview, student and teacher materials, as well as step-by-step directions. We want to give you an example of a compelling question and how the supporting questions can scaffold it. And to do so, we're going to look at the US history and world lesson that we've been speaking about. This is one that addresses reparative justice and whether or not the city of Tulsa has made amends for the Tulsa Race Massacre. If you look at the four supporting questions, we start by looking at how the Greenwood District, where Black Wall Street is, was developed, the crimes and costs that are associated with the Tulsa Race Massacre, the steps that other governments have taken for repair, and to compare it to the steps that Tulsa has made and has not made in order to facilitate reparative justice. We're going to focus on supporting question number two as an example of what the interactive activities that incorporate primary and secondary sources can look like. And to do so, Emily is going to talk to you about what we've included in supporting question two.
So supporting question two is having students identify the crimes committed during the Tulsa massacre and estimating the possible cost to the victims. So supporting question two will start with a visual investigation in which students make predictions on what happened. They also watch a short video on the causes and do a reading on the massacre and the aftermath. They will review primary source testimonies on the crimes and the costs. They look at statistical data as well on the losses of the massacre. And they will then create a written response to the supporting question. So this is the investigation sheet that students will receive to do a visual inquiry activity for supporting question two. And this is a stations activity where students are going to have images from the National Archives that are out on the table, and they go around and look at these different images. So what they are going to answer, what questions they'll answer when they look at the images are what they notice, what they wonder. They then make a prediction of what happened in the Tulsa Race Massacre based on the photo, and then make a prediction of the cost to the victims. So here are two photographs that come from this activity. So I'm going to ask that Akela and Tametra share with us how their students would likely respond to these questions. So Akela, would you be able to share how your elementary school students would likely respond to these photographs?
Yes, elementary students would immediately say that the pictures look very old. They would predict that a fire occurred or maybe an explosion. They'd also make note of the clothes that the people were wearing in the picture.
For the middle school, they would notice, of course, the rubble as well, but probably more how did they rebuild this area and the expense of it. So they would definitely notice those things and also try to figure out what happened and how they can help someone else if that happened to them.
Thank you. So after students go around to all of the stations and they've looked at every photograph, then as their teacher, you would tell them that what these photographs depict are the 35 square blocks of Greenwood that was destroyed from the massacre. So here's another photograph that would be part of this activity. So I'm gonna ask Akela and Tametra to do the same thing, to respond kind of how their students would respond. So Akela, how would elementary school students respond to this photograph?
They would have very literal responses. They would say that they see men holding their hands up. They would notice the buildings and the cars in the background and the clothes that the people were wearing, to determine what time period this occurred. And they would also, some of them would notice the date and the caption.
In middle school, they would notice the stance that the gentlemen are having. They were related to the protest and many of the protests around the nation for injustice. We have heard the statement, "Hands up, don't shoot." And so they would notice that these men are doing the same thing that some of them have done over the years at protest.
That would be a really good observation and connection that students could make. So after the activity where students look at all of the photos, you would then tell them that what this photograph is of are Black men who were arrested and detained and then later blamed for causing the Tulsa Race Massacre. After this activity, students would then watch a video on the causes of the Tulsa Race Massacre and complete a reading on the Tulsa Race Massacre and the aftermath. So now Tametra is going to introduce you to an activity that helps identify some of the costs of the Tulsa Race Massacre.
Thank you. So one thing about the cost with the Tulsa Race Massacre is that you can relate this to any event massacre that has happened over the nation. So it doesn't just have to be Tulsa. You can use these skills with other areas. One of the costs was that many of the victims were denied insurance money. Many of the Blacks were blamed for the massacre. The loss of accumulated wealth, for instance, your parents' economic status, which is usually passed down, those things were lost. My own family lost their possessions, of course, if I stated, and the loss of income earnings, their jobs, death of family members, many, we have no idea where they are. There are mass graves around the city. And the physical and emotional trauma that is passed down multi-generation. One of our activities, which is a great interactive activity, is the NPR recording of Miss Olivia Hooker. At the time in her senior days, she was recorded on NPR giving an account of what happened with her and how her family survived. So while we listen, please think of what experiences could have happened.
It was May 31st, 1921. At first, we saw a bunch of men with those big pine torches come through the backyard. And I remember our mother put us under the table. She took the longest tablecloth she had to cover four children and told us not to say a word. It was a horrifying thing for a little girl that's only 6 years old, trying to remember to keep quiet so they wouldn't know we were there. As those marauders came into the house, they were trying to destroy anything that they could find. They took a huge axe and started whacking at my sister Irene's beloved piano. Whack, whack, whack. It was a good piano, and they thought that was something we shouldn't have.
Thank you. Akela, how would your students respond?
Yeah, so for elementary students, I would probably have to adapt the question a little bit. And I would ask them, what did Olivia Hooker's family lose? And they would be able to notice that her family lost their piano and that their family lost their business.
Okay. And Emily, what about high school?
What I think my high school students would make a connection to is that Olivia Hooker's father was an entrepreneur. He owned his own business, and because of the Tulsa Race Massacre, in literally seconds, all of that was gone. And so thinking about the potential generational wealth that was lost out on, that Olivia, only being 5 years old when the massacre happened, could have grown up to be the owner of that store.
There are some more primary source testimonies available for you. And Akela is going to tell you about some supporting questions for all our lessons.
Yeah, so I want to mention that all of the lessons have the same structure. So although you can adapt the primary resources from the world history lesson as we just did for elementary and middle school students, the elementary and middle school lessons still have primary resources that are grade level appropriate and interactive activities to follow for those supporting questions. And now Amanda will share information on our summative task.
Thanks, Akela. Our summative performance tasks answers each of the compelling questions, and our students work on them throughout the entire lesson. An example that we have from the US and World History lesson on making amends is that our students write a government official or a newspaper answering whether or not they believe the city of Tulsa has made amends, and if it hasn't, the steps that Tulsa needs to make. You saw a moment ago a document that Akela was showing us. Emily, could you flip that slide? Thank you. Looks like this, and it has all of the supporting questions and all of the summative performance tasks. So in the right column, you'll see a summary of the performance task per lesson. Emily, do you want to go ahead and review the high school tasks, please?
Yes, so Amanda already talked about the world history summative task, but for government, we have students creating a mock legal report in which they determine whether or not there's legal standing for reparations. And then in the US history lesson for high school, we have students writing a letter to a textbook publisher on how the history of the Tulsa Race Massacre should be told. So with my experience teaching the US history lesson, one thing that I noticed is that after my students wrote their letter, they would come up to me and say, hey, Ms. Harris, do you have any stamps? I have to send this letter. So they weren't just thinking about this as like a test or a summative assessment. They were, in their minds, they knew that they were taking informed action and that they were making a difference in their community. So Tametra, would you be able to share about the middle school summative assessments?
Yes, real quick, middle school, we really did a lot of interactive activities, really playing into technology along with personal discussion. For eighth grade, they created a text message based off of the poem, If We Must Die by Claude McClay. Seventh grade, of course, they created a Flipgrid video explaining the losses. And in sixth grade, they created a storyboard dealing with pre-race massacre and after. So really great activities, interactive and technology driven. Akela, can you tell us about the elementary schools?
Yeah, so the fifth graders will create the Resilient Times newspaper. And they work on this newspaper throughout the lesson. So it's not a project that they just do at the end. After each supporting question, they write an article that answers the question, and that will be a part of their newspaper. And the same thing for the fourth graders, they will create a Flipgrid video. They take notes and answer questions after each supporting question that will help them to create their video at the end of the lesson. So now Emily will talk to you about our video library.
We are going to take the final minutes that we have here to talk about some resources that we have located on the bottom of our cheat sheet. So the first in those is the Tulsa Public Schools video library. These videos were made to incorporate into the lessons. And in fact, the video that we watched at the beginning of this presentation was one of those videos that Tulsa Public Schools made. These videos are all 5 to 10 minutes in length, and they include interviews that we were able to conduct with experts on the Tulsa Race Massacre. And we also got local community leaders to participate in these videos as well. So the topics for those videos are listed on our website, and Tametra is gonna give you information about cross-curricular resources.
Our cross-curricular resources, I'm an English background, so we did a lot of curriculum planning to incorporate English, fine arts, and social studies. We have different novels that you can go along with, like for instance, with the Holocaust. Also, we love music. We know kids do it as well. So great music video available for you. Akela, what about the elementary?
Yes, now there are more children's books available than previously before, due to the centennial, that that you can also incorporate into your language arts classes. We also have our Tulsa Public Schools webpage that combines all of the resources in one place. So all of the videos, everything is in one place. Here is our contact information that is also located at the bottom of our cheat sheet. Now, Amanda will share feedback that we received on our lessons.
Thanks, Akela. We wanted to end with really talking about the student and teacher experience. We surveyed students and got together some focus groups, and we noticed overall that the student experience was very positive. They had a high level of interest in the topics. Of course, anytime we talk about issues like racism, there are students that struggle during this time. And we noticed that some of the responses that they gave was tied to some misinformation. Akela, do you want to take a moment and discuss any of the responses that your students had in your elementary classroom?
Yes, as I mentioned before, one class was very emotional. The other class was very talkative. They just kept wanting to share how they felt and they wanted to share with other people. I had one student that wanted to buy a Greenwood or Black Wall Street t-shirt. A lot of them were available during the centennial celebrations. And she went home and asked her parents to buy one, and they didn't understand why she would want it because they didn't know anything about it. So she was very excited to go home and share with her family about it. Also, many of my Black students were frustrated that more Black history hasn't been taught before. And so even at 10 and 11 years old, they're able to articulate these things. Tametra, what were some of the feedback that you got from your middle school students?
Well, with the middle school, they were so involved in learning about history and what went on in the world that they wanted more enrichment activities. We investigated and used a lot of resources like from the Smithsonian, along with our local institutes like Greenwood Culture Center. So our students just love the idea of learning about our history. Emily, what about high school?
So not everything about teaching hard history is always going to go very smoothly. We know that strong emotions are going to be felt. But I gauged my success in teaching these lessons by going around and listening to the meaningful conversations that students were having. And I could tell from their engagement how much they really cared about these lessons. So it's really important now more than ever that we have our kids discussing issues of racism and racial justice. And these Tulsa Race Massacre lessons that we are showing you, this is the space for that. So next, Tametra is going to give some closing remarks.
One thing we want you to take away from this is that you have all of these resources available. We're so grateful for building them. We thank you for taking time to learn how to use this tragedy to better all of our students to persevere and become informed and open that dialogue for healing. For 80 years, Tulsa did not formally acknowledge the Tulsa Race Massacre or attempt to heal our community. Our silence resulted in the community still grappling with the damage of racial violence and the lasting impact on structural discrimination. There's a survey in the chat for you. Please take a moment to fill it out. If you have any questions, I think Rookie, we might have 1 minute for one by chance, if there is one.
I think we're unfortunately out of time, but I do want to take our last minute to thank you for an amazing session. You've done some amazing work and you've gotten a lot of compliments in the chat and the questions for all of your hard work. So from all of us who have listened to you today, thank you for the work you're doing. We appreciate and support the work you're doing and thank you for sharing it with us today. I think you have a slide with your contact information. So if you would put that back on, I'm sure a lot of the attendees would love to stay in touch with you. Thank you all again. And this was a terrific session.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you.